English Lecture Series. I'm Karen Matthews of University Video Communications. Our program is designed to enrich graduate and upper division curricula with academic presentations by top computer scientists from industry. Its speakers and topics were nominated by computer science faculty of more than 50 universities. This presentation is sponsored by Tektronix Laboratory, Tektronix Incorporated. Dr. William Klinger, a leading figure in the recent evolution of the Scheme programming language, received his Ph.D. in mathematics from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in 1981. He served on the faculty at Indiana University and since 1985 has been principal scientist with Tektronix Computer Research Laboratory. His work has included design, specification, and implementation of advanced programming languages. He is a principal author of MaxScheme. His talk today is Compiler Optimization for Symbolic Languages. It's our pleasure to introduce Dr. William Klinger. Will?
Thank you, Karen. In talking about symbolic languages, I first have to give you some idea of what I'm talking about. Symbolic languages are languages used for symbolic computation, as opposed to numerical computation, which you would expect to find a language such as Fortran. I find it easier to define symbolic languages by example than by any strict definitions, any formal definition. And so Smalltalk is an example of a symbolic language. It's, in fact, the leading example of an object-oriented programming language. Scheme is an example. It's a dialect of Lisp, a very simple dialect of Lisp that's been used for a great deal of the modern research on compiler optimization in Lisp-like languages. ML is a language very much like Scheme, but it's statically typed and is notable for its ability to infer types without any need for the programmer to give those types as declarations. And I listed ML in my list of examples today primarily to show that symbolic languages do not have to be dynamically typed. They can be statically typed. Common Lisp is a leading commercial example of a symbolic language. Symbolic languages, as I characterize the term, have a number of features in common. One of them is first-class objects. Now, by that I mean that objects in these languages, symbolic objects, are just as convenient and easy to manipulate as numbers or integers in a conventional programming language. So to understand what that means, well, you can store any structure, any object, in a structure. It can be a component of a data structure. It can be passed as an argument to a procedure. It can be returned as a result from a procedure. These are the sorts of things that are necessary if something is to be a truly first-class citizen of a programming language. But there are a few things that aren't quite so obvious. It's important that first-class objects be usable without having to give them a name. Imagine what it would be like if, in writing a program, you had to give a name to every integer created during the computation. You say I plus 1, you get a new integer. You have to give it a name before you can use it. That would be completely impractical. And yet there are many programming languages that force such important objects as procedures to be named before they can be used. Another example has to do with storage allocation. Suppose whenever you created an integer in the course of a computation, you had to remember you've created that integer and dispose of storage for it when you're through with it, or do something else when you're done with that particular integer. That would not be at all practical. And so if general objects are to be as convenient to use as integers, then we can't afford to give them any more thought to their storage than we give to the storage occupied by an integer. And that leads to a need for automatic garbage collection in symbolic languages. The system must be responsible for reclaiming any storage that's allocated. Another thing that characterizes symbolic languages is the number of dynamic or runtime checks that occur during the computation. Symbolic languages have more of these checks than in conventional languages simply because of the nature of symbolic computation. In a numerical routine, you know what multiplications and additions you're going to do before you go through the routine, and it's merely the results of those multiplications that differ. But in symbolic computation, the computation itself is directed more by the nature of the data, and so you have to do more tests against that data. Another characteristic of symbolic computation is that you have a relatively large number of procedure calls, or in the case of small talk, message sends. Let's look at first-class objects a little bit more. Lisp was an important language in its use of linked lists as a first-class object, where the system, the runtime system, was responsible for managing the storage occupied by these linked lists. They could be used in a very convenient manner. In modern dialects of Lisp and in most symbolic languages, procedures are also first-class. We'll say more what that means in a moment. Smalltalk is an example of a language that unifies the concepts of procedures and data structures into a new concept of an object. There are other things that may be first-class objects that aren't first-class in conventional programming languages. Continuations, for example, in languages like Scheme and Smalltalk must in general be first-class objects. That impacts the runtime system more than it does the compiler, fortunately, and there's very little efficiency lost from that, but it's still a consideration. The dynamic checks come about from a number of characteristics of symbolic computation. If you have a linked list as a type, that is really a union type. A linked list is either a node in the list with a link in it, or it's the empty list. And so that union type leads to runtime type checks as the program seeks to find whether it's been given an empty list or a non-empty list. And that's inevitable. You have to make those type checks. Symbolic languages generally use generic arithmetic. That is, they do not do integer arithmetic modulo 2 to the 32. They try to do a better approximation to the real integers, or the real numbers, or the complex numbers. In some languages, all these numbers are treated the same, and the program is responsible for performing any representation conversions that must be necessary to represent a number if it overflows the range that can be represented in a single register, for example. And that is the responsibility of the runtime system. Subscript range checks are also necessary in symbolic languages to a large extent because symbolic languages are generally used for interactive program development. And where it would be acceptable in some languages to have a core dump when you have an out-of-range subscript error, in symbolic language, that kind of error must be trapped so that the programmer can examine the state of the computation, find the problem, and continue. The reason this is necessary, particularly in symbolic languages, to avoid stopping the session or computation, is that if you fetch something that you shouldn't, it may break the garbage collector. So here's a way in which the garbage collector affects some other aspect of the system that isn't at all obvious on first sight. Finally, many of the symbolic languages are, in fact, dynamically typed, and that does create a need for runtime type checks. So the runtime system is responsible for storage management, storage allocation, and reclamation. It's responsible for implementing procedure calls, which may be more expensive in some of these symbolic languages, as well as more frequent. For example, in Smalltalk, a message send, which is the analog of a procedure call, may involve a dynamic method lookup. That's true in object-oriented extensions to other languages as well. So here we are, we have even more procedure calls, we need to make them fast, and yet their semantics is very complicated. The compiler can help with a lot of these, but the runtime system must truly be efficient if the language is to be implemented well. The runtime system's performance is affected by its ability to extract tags for type checks, by its ability to do fast range checks on subscripts, and finally by its ability to do generic arithmetic fast. These are all the responsibility of the runtime system, and it's essential that the runtime system do a good job, because the compiler cannot do this. In general, the runtime system must. However, the compiler can create less garbage so that the garbage collector has less work to do. The compiler can eliminate or simplify procedure calls so that there's less runtime overhead there. The compiler can do its best to eliminate tag checks, as for example by type inference in ML. And finally, the compiler can, where it can deduce the representation of a number, use specific arithmetic as provided by primitive hardware instructions, rather than the more general library routines that may be necessary in the general case. I want to return now to the concept of first-class objects and consider particularly why first-class procedures, or first-class objects in the Smalltalk sense, because to the compiler writer they're pretty much the same thing, are difficult to implement efficiently. If you have ever written a compiler for Pascal or any other block-structured language in which you can pass a procedure as an argument, then you're familiar with the concept of a closure. A closure consists of two things: a pointer to the code for the procedure and a pointer to a data structure called an environment that contains the variables referred to by the code, the free variables referred to by the code. And when you pass a procedure as a parameter in Pascal, you must pass both these pieces of information, the code and the environment. Now, the environment's called by many names in conventional compiler text. It may be known as a frame pointer. It may be known as a static link, but I'm going to call it the environment. In symbolic languages, in general, procedures must be data structures in their own right, consisting of those two things, the code and the environment, and this data structure is called a closure. In general, these closures must be allocated storage on a garbage collected heap. For example, here's a piece of scheme code illustrating a procedure called make counter, which takes an argument in, the initial value for a counter, and returns a procedure of no arguments. That's what the lambda and then the two parentheses with nothing in between means. That procedure, when you call it, will increment the value of n and then return the new value of n. Since the procedure is returned and must remember the variable n, not just its value, in fact, but the variable itself, its location in the store, the variable n must be allocated in garbage collected memory as well. We can't keep in a register. In this case, we cannot keep in on a stack. We must allocate the argument in garbage collected storage. So both the procedure and the environment in this case must be allocated in garbage collected storage, and that is in fact the general case in symbolic languages. So now we get to the meaning of compiler optimization. Compiler optimization refers to making code better than the most general case. A compiler in general must produce a certain form of code for each construct in the language if, when possible, it does better than the most general code, then we say that the compiler did some optimization at that place. Well, in these symbolic languages, all procedures must be allocated on the heap in general. I mean, that's the general mechanism. Environments must be allocated on the heap. And so we must do compiler optimization merely to avoid creating all this garbage, or storage that will eventually become garbage in all probability. And these are the most important optimizations for a symbolic language. Another important optimization is procedure integration. In the previous slide, I showed an environment, or in a previous slide, we're looking at a procedure here that has a free variable, has two free variables in it. Not only n, but plus is a free variable as well. And since plus is a free variable, if that's a generic addition routine, we may have to allocate that in the environment. But we'd rather not do that. And one way to avoid doing that is to generate inline code for plus. And that is an example of procedure integration. When we know the procedure we're calling, we can generate better code than if we don't know the procedure we're calling. Procedure integration, a compiler will typically deal with several forms of procedure integration. One form is the most general calling conventions supported by the runtime system. That's a general linkage that the compiler will use if it can't figure out anything better. If the compiler is calling a known procedure such as plus, then it can often generate inline code. And of course, that's the best that you could hope for. There are various in-between cases where the compiler knows something about the procedure it's calling, but the procedure is recursive, or for some other reason it isn't practical to expand the code for the body of that procedure inline, and the compiler can use various kinds of custom linkage. Another important optimization, essential for some symbolic languages, such as Scheme and ML, is known as tail recursion optimization. And that has to do with making it so that procedure calls that return the value to be returned by a procedure, such as MIMQ here. Let me go through MIMQ, and we'll see an example. That's the easiest way to do it. MIMQ here is defined as a procedure that takes two arguments, anything, X, and a list. If the list is null, then it returns false. If the thing it's passed as its first argument, X, is EQ to the first thing in the list, the car of the list, then it returns the list. Otherwise, it calls itself recursively on X and the coder of the list, or the rest of the list. So it simply skips down the list looking for X. That last call to MIMQ is a tail recursive call because its value is the value to be returned by the original call to MIMQ. And so we do not have to create a new continuation, that is, push a new stack frame or anything for that call. We can effectively jump to MIMQ once we've set up the arguments in the proper way. And that is an example of tail recursion. When a call is going to return the value that you want to return, then you've got an example of tail recursion. And the code that might be compiled for the MIMQ procedure is shown in this slide. I'm going to walk through this slide to give you, to tell you what the semantics of my assembly language instructions are, because no computer like this has ever been built, to my knowledge. But I'm going to assume that the arguments come in registers R1 and R2. The first instruction asks whether the value in R2, that is the list, is null, and it stores the result of that question in the register R3. That will be a Boolean, of course. If the result of that question is false, then we'll branch to L1. Otherwise, we return false. Okay. At L1, we're in the second clause of the cond expression. We need to ask if X is EQ to the car of the list. So we compute the car of the list into R4. We ask if it's EQ to X, which is in R1, and we put the result of that comparison in R5. If they're not EQ, then we'll branch to L2. Otherwise, we return the list, which is in R2. At L2, we have the tail recursive call. We need to compute the argument for the call, which is the coder of list. We'll put that in R8. We will fetch the procedure we're calling and stick that in R7, because in most symbolic languages, the function or procedure position of a call is evaluated the same way as any other position. So we have a variable reference there to MIMQ. And then we have a call instruction. I need to tell you about this call instruction. This call instruction does not push stack, push a return address, stick a return address in a register, or anything else. What it does is it does some register shuffling to put the arguments in registers. So the arguments which are in R1 and R6 will get placed in R1 and R2 through a parallel assignment. And it effectively jumps to the closure in R7. Now, I say effectively jumps to a closure. There are two respects, there are two aspects of that. I've shown here a closure sitting in R7. The code of that closure must be stored into the PC by the call instruction or the program counter, and the environment part of that closure must be stored in the environment register, which I'll assume. The environment register might be known as a frame pointer in a conventional language. Now, that's tail recursion. In addition to tail recursion optimization, we can do some procedure integration here because the compiler is likely to be able to figure out that MIMQ is calling itself. Whether the compiler can indeed figure that out depends on rather subtle aspects of the language semantics, but let's assume that it can. Then, instead of going through the relatively slow calling sequence that we had before, we can simply compute the argument back into the same register as before. That's a conventional optimization, register targeting, and branch back to the beginning of the procedure, because this is self-recursion. We've got a procedure calling itself. That can just be a branch, because it's self-tail recursion. So with these two optimizations, tail recursion optimization, which avoids the creation of a new continuation frame or stack frame when the call is performed, and procedure integration, which compiles this particular call as a branch instruction, you can see that the code that we get is comparable to that produced by iteration in a conventional language. And that's very important for languages like Scheme and ML, because all iteration is expressed by means of recursion. That's the only way you can write a loop, is to use recursion. Okay, I've shown you a tail recursive call. We have to see now, well, how would in the world would you go about doing a non-tail recursive call? That is, a call where the result is not going to be returned immediately as the result of the procedure doing the call. I've written here a procedure called prior to, which returns the elements of a list X prior to an element X. And the first part of it is very similar to the MemQ procedure that I was showing earlier. We first ask if the list is null. If it is, we return the empty list. We then ask if the car of the list is EQ to X. If it is, we return the empty list. Otherwise, we cons the car of list onto the result of calling prior to on X and the coder of the list. Now, that last call to prior to is not a tail recursive call, because when we've gotten the result back, we still have to cons the car of the list onto it before we are ready to return the value of this procedure. So that is the difference between a tail recursive and a non-tail recursive call. One way to think about it, as Guy Steele put it in his master's thesis, it is not procedure calls that push stack, it is argument evaluation that pushes stack. See, we are evaluating an argument to cons here, and that is why we must create a new stack frame or continuation frame. It's not the fact that we're doing a procedure call. Well, the assembly code generated for this example starts out very much the same as the prior example, so I'm not going to go through it in any great detail. But here's the interesting part, the non-tail recursive call. And I've duplicated that at the top of the slide. We need to cons the car of the list onto prior to of X and the coder of the list. So we need to compute the car of the list either before or after the call to prior to. Here, it doesn't make any difference. So I've got it evaluated before the call to prior to. We compute the car of the list into R6, and then we have a save instruction. This is what creates the continuation frame. The save instruction, and the semantics of this save instruction are, it creates a new continuation frame, stores the return address L3 into it, and also saves the value of register R6, because we're going to need that register when we come back. No other registers are live at this point, and so or need to be saved across the call, rather. So that's all that we have to save. And this is a caller saves discipline. The calling procedure is responsible for saving its registers, anything that might have to be saved. That does simplify the optimization of tail recursion, though it's not essential. Okay, now we're ready for the non-tail recursive call. We've created our continuation frame so we can come back to the right place. We compute the coder of the list as an argument for the call. We fetch the value of prior to, and we perform the call. And again, the call instruction here does not create a continuation frame. When we come back to L3, we will restore the former value of R6. That's the car of the list being restored into R6. I'm assuming here that results are returned in R1, and so all we have to do is to cons that saved value R6 onto the result of the call in R1, getting a new value in R9, which we can then return as the result of the procedure. Let's return to the first part of the procedure that I skipped over very quickly here, and examine the instructions at L1 and at L2. The instruction at L1 is computing the car of the list. The instruction at L2 is computing the car of the list. The second instruction is redundant. We've already computed the car. So this is an example where a compiler could perform common sub-expression elimination. However, we can't just do common sub-expression elimination across basic blocks in this example, because there's a branch instruction that intervenes between those two instructions. In general, in symbolic languages, basic blocks are not sufficient for common sub-expression elimination, because there are so many conditional tests in these languages in their typical use that you just wouldn't pick up very many common sub-expressions to eliminate. You need to do some kind of common sub-expression elimination through the various paths in a procedure. You need to make some kind of attempt at that. And that's one respect in which symbolic languages are different from conventional languages. So far, then, we've seen these six optimizations: procedure integration, closure analysis, where we try to avoid allocating storage for a closure, because we can tell that the closure is just going to be called immediately or something like that. Environment analysis, where we try to find places where variables do not have to be allocated in a garbage collected heap but can be kept in registers or on a stack instead. Tail recursion optimization, and then the conventional optimizations of register allocation and targeting and common sub-expression elimination. Another word here about common sub-expression elimination. In conventional languages, common sub-expressions come up not so much because the programmer writes them, but because things that the programmer writes in array subscripts and other places turn into common sub-expressions when expanded by the compiler into the underlying arithmetic needed to compute those subscripts. The same thing happens in symbolic languages, though in a slightly the source of the common sub-expressions is slightly different. The common sub-expressions in symbolic languages tend to come from various runtime checks, tag checks, type checks, testing for the end of a list, and so on. For example, in the memq procedure, which searches a list for the occurrence of an object X, we look at the procedure and we do not see any common sub-expressions worth eliminating. But if we expand the car and coulda operations, as in this next slide, then we see that car and coulda really are implemented in terms of a pair check. We must check to make sure that something's a pair before we take its car or coulda at the machine level. And so in this slide, where percent %car is a non-checking form of the car instruction and percent %coulda is a non-checking form of the coulda instruction, by exposing these underlying operations, we have obtained a common sub-expression which could then be eliminated by the compiler. And so just as when we're writing an optimizing compiler for a conventional language, it's important that we be able to expose the operations at a low enough level that we can uncover these common sub-expressions and eliminate them. Another aspect of compiling for a symbolic language that does not come up with conventional language is how the compiler must deal with garbage collection. Garbage collection is primarily the responsibility of the runtime system, and the compiler doesn't have to worry about it very much. However, it does affect the way the compiler allocates registers and so on. And to see why, let's think of garbage collection as a graph algorithm. The job of garbage collection, or part of the job of garbage collection, is to locate all nodes that are accessible from a given set of root nodes. In this slide, I've got four small boxes at the top representing the roots. And then the nodes that are within the larger box represent all the nodes in that graph that are accessible from those roots. So the garbage collector must be able to tell what the root nodes are from which it is to begin its graph traversal. Usually, those root nodes are certain registers. And this leads to a partition of the registers by the compiler. Whenever the garbage collector might run, and the compiler has to know when that might happen. In some compilers, the garbage collector can run between any two instructions. With other compilers, the compiler only lets the garbage collector run at certain known times when various registers may be dead. But anyway, the garbage collector must know which registers it should use in tracing out the accessible nodes. And so the compiler generally partitions the registers into rootable and non-rootable nodes. Registers. The rootable registers are those that the garbage collector uses to begin its traversal. And in this example, if we had eight registers, for example, we might divide them up by allocating R0 as the environment register. We might use R1 through R4 as general purpose rootable registers, R5 and R6 as scratch registers that are not rootable, and R7 we could reserve as a continuation register. Now, we must also face the fact that in these symbolic languages, we often can't tell what something is just by looking at its bit pattern. For example, if it's in a non-rootable register, 400000 as a hexadecimal number, that might be a floating point 2, or it might be a pointer to a pair or a con cell located at location 0 in the machine. And the garbage collector, just looking at that with no knowledge of its context, would not know. But if that's in a rootable register, then it would be a tagged pointer, and the garbage collector could interpret that as a pointer to a con cell. whereas if it's in a scratch register, then it might be a floating point number and the compiler is simply doing some arithmetic on it. This example also shows that there's a problem with doing floating point arithmetic on stock hardware in many of these symbolic languages, because the floating point 2 might be interpreted as a tag pointer, and that might confuse the garbage collector. This is generally resolved by having the compiler maintain a distinction between the rootable and non-rootable registers. And arithmetic's done in the scratch registers. When you create a new floating point number as a result of an addition, for example, in general, you have to allocate storage for that resulting floating point number in a garbage collected heap. You can't just leave it lying in a register. So that's another source of possible inefficiency associated with symbolic languages that the compiler can do its best to optimize away. So, for example, in this case, where we have an addition of 4.5 times x, adding that to 1.25, even if we don't know anything about the representation of x, we can know that the result of the multiplication is going to be a floating point or perhaps a complex number. And since that number is only going to be used as the first operand to the addition procedure, we do not have to allocate storage for that particular floating point or complex number on the heap. It is possible for the compiler to try and keep that in a register, thereby saving the creation of more garbage. That is, not create the garbage associated with that storage. So that's an example of representation analysis that the compiler can perform to generate better code. Here is one last fairly extreme example to show many of the optimizations that we've seen so far. It's an example that takes the inner product of two vectors. It's written in Scheme, but similar code would be written in many of these other languages. And it starts out by letting n1 and n2 be the lengths of the vectors, and then it defines a help procedure, IP, which is essentially the loop that performs the inner product computation. But first it checks to make sure the two vectors that are passed in are of the same length. If they are, then it loops with initial value for I of 0 and an initial value for sum of 0.0. Now, the compiler, if it knows vector length, if it knows what that procedure is, then it can deduce quite a bit about this code. It knows that if the code gets past the two calls to vector length, then it knows that v1 and v2 are legitimate vectors. It knows that n1 and n2 are the lengths of those vectors. Furthermore, it probably knows that the length of any vector is an exact fixed num, that is, an integer that's small enough to be stored in a register in an immediate format rather than being allocated out on the garbage collected heap. And so the compiler can deduce quite a bit about v1, v2, n1, and n2 just by looking at this code. That's similar to the type inference performed by ML. Similar, but it can also be performed to some extent even in a dynamically typed language, provided these procedures, vector length, and so on, are known. And that allows the compiler, for example, in the equality test of n1 against n2, to use specific arithmetic instructions rather than the most generic arithmetic comparisons. The help procedure IP is shown in this slide. The help procedure appears in the lexical context of V1, V2, N1, and N2. It was where the three dots were in the previous slide. So that's where those free variables are going to come from. It starts out by asking if I is equal to N1. If so, then we've reached the end of both vectors, and we can simply return the sum, which is being used as an accumulator. Otherwise, we loop tail recursively, calling IP on I plus 1, and the result of adding to the sum the product of the corresponding elements of the two vectors. So the compiler, by looking at this, if it's a really, really fancy compiler, might be able to reason as follows. It knows that the initial value of I is 0, because we saw that in the previous slide. When IP is first called, I is 0. It knows that N1 is a non-negative integer because it's the length of a vector. Okay, I starts out at 0. It's incremented by 1 each time around the loop. We're testing against a non-negative integer value to terminate the loop, the compiler can deduce from that, if it's really clever, that I is a non-negative integer between 0 and N1 inclusive. That's an example of fairly conventional compiler optimization. It's a loop optimization, basically. Now, it's a fairly fancy loop optimization, but it's certainly feasible. And so this is to show that it can be done even in symbolic languages. Ultimately, the compiler should be able to deduce, if it's smart enough, that V1 and V2 are vectors with N1 elements. N1 is an exact integer. It's a non-negative integer, and there's probably some maximum size that a vector can have, and we know that N1 is less than or equal to that size. We know that I is also an exact integer, which means we probably know its representation. We know it's smaller than N1 and greater than 0, so we know indeed that it is small enough to be fit in a register, probably. We don't know a whole lot about sum, except that it started out as 0.0 and is the result of some multiplications and additions that involve sum, and so about all we can say about sum is that it's an inexact number. We don't know whether it's a real or a complex, but we know that it's an inexact number. Making use of that information, the compiler should perform the following optimizations. Number one, since IP is a procedure declared locally that is only called, it is never passed out, through closure analysis, the compiler should know not to allocate a closure object for IP. It should simply perform the call as you would in Pascal, say. The compiler should also compile the calls to IP as branches. That's a combination of two optimizations, tail recursion optimization and procedure integration. The compiler should keep V1, V2, N1, N2, I, and sum in registers, if it's got enough registers. That's environment optimization. The compiler figures out that those variables are never referred to by a closure that escapes the current context, and so those variables have a bounded lifetime, and the compiler can just keep them in registers, or at least they can keep them on a stack. The compiler may want to keep sum in a non-rootable register because, being an inexact number, it would ordinarily have to be allocated storage on the garbage collected heap. We don't want to do that if we can help it. The compiler should use specific arithmetic where possible. That's another example of representation analysis. The addition of I, the increment of I each time through the loop, can be done without checking to see how I is represented, without even checking for overflow, because we know I's range. We can't do that for sum. When we multiply the corresponding elements of the vectors, we don't know what kind of numbers we're multiplying together, and so we have to use generic arithmetic there. But in the loop arithmetic itself, we can use specific arithmetic. The compiler can eliminate type checks for V1 and V2 when it references the ith element of V1 and V2. There's no need for that because we know that they're both vectors. We don't have to do range checks for I because we know it's in range. And another optimization that's a conventional optimization that I haven't talked about, if to fetch the ith element of a vector, we would have to shift I by a couple of bits, say, then we might want to represent I by a multiple of I throughout the loop in a pre-shifted form, thereby avoiding the shift each time through the loop. This is a conventional optimization. Now, the bottom three are conventional optimizations, or rather the bottom two are conventional optimizations, and the third one from the bottom, eliminating the type checks, would not be necessary in a statically typed language. All the optimizations above that are real new optimizations that are necessary whether the language is statically typed or not. So one of the things that we see from this example is that static typing by itself does not necessarily buy you a lot in a symbolic programming language, and I think that's one of the reasons why symbolic languages are often dynamically typed. Static typing does find many type errors at compile time, and that is the advantage of static languages. It is not an efficiency advantage, but one of greater reliability. So we've now reviewed most of the optimizations that we've seen, and they're all bound up in this one example. The things I want to say at this point are, we've seen that optimization is more important for symbolic language than it is for a conventional language. And the reason for that is simply that if you don't do some optimization, at least closure analysis, at least environment analysis, you're going to wind up allocating all your variables on a garbage collected heap, and you won't get any kind of performance. it turns out that the difference between an optimizing and a straightforward non-optimizing compiler that does a little bit better than what I just said but does not do much else is probably about a factor of 10 for a symbolic language. For conventional languages, you'd expect to see more like a factor of 2 or 3. And so optimization is really more important. It makes a bigger difference for symbolic languages than it usually does for conventional languages. The other thing to be said about compiler optimization for symbolic languages is that no matter how good your compiler is, you're still going to have to spend a lot of time working on the runtime system. Because no matter how good the compiler is, there's going to be a lot of things the compiler can't do. There are going to be some procedure calls that the compiler can't do anything with. There are going to be some cases where the arithmetic is completely generic, and so on. And so you have to do a good job on your runtime system in order to get good performance. And that's another way in which symbolic languages differ from conventional languages. Because conventional languages, you build the runtime system. It's pretty simple. It doesn't matter a whole lot to performance, except perhaps to I/O. Now, just listing on this slide the optimizations we've seen here, roughly in descending order of importance, I would say procedure integration, so that when we know the procedure we're calling, we do something good to make it fast. Tail recursion optimization, which is essential for some languages. Closure analysis and environment analysis to avoid allocating structures on a garbage collected heap where it's not necessary. Representation analysis to do a better job of choosing a more efficient representation for some variable or value. Type and range inference, which is necessary to make some of these other optimizations work, such as representation analysis, and then the conventional optimizations, such as common sub-expression elimination, and doing a good job of register allocation at the bottom. Now, that's not to say these things at the bottom, these conventional optimizations, are unimportant. They are important, but it's the newer optimizations, the things that you don't have to do in a conventional language, that are even more important for a symbolic language, and that's how they're different.
I'm Judith Lemon from University Video Communications. Our first question is from the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. Will, how do you deal with compiling continuations efficiently in languages like Scheme, where continuations may be copied dynamically from the stack to a heap?
Okay. Well, first let me explain how this comes up. In Scheme, when you call a certain procedure named call with current continuation, it may be necessary to copy the continuation or stack from a stack structure into a garbage collected heap because it would then have unbounded lifetime. Normally, however, its lifetime is bounded and it can be kept in the stack. It's not unique to Scheme. Smalltalk block contexts are like that. It's primarily the responsibility of the runtime system to perform this copying when necessary. It can only be detected dynamically. The compiler hasn't got a prayer. And so it's the runtime system that has to do the copying, and when you invoke that continuation later through some kind of return or throw, maybe copy it back into the stack or maybe just run right out of the heap. It does affect the compiler in a few respects, however, because the fact that you've copied the continuation out of a stack into the heap and you may resume it later means that you can't have any direct pointers to a stack frame or something like that. Furthermore, because there are copies that are being made and moved around, you generally can't have any side effects to your stack frames. And this means you can't store variables in stack frames per se. The variable must at least be indirect. And that is the extent to which it affects the compiler. It's mainly the runtime system, but the compiler has to be careful not to get in the way.
Second question. We received many requests from faculty regarding compiler optimization. Why is this such an important issue?
Well, because if I go out and spend $10,000 for a machine because it runs twice as fast as a machine that costs $5,000, then I'm going to be unhappy if somebody writes a really whiz-bang compiler for the $5,000 machine that makes it run just as fast as my $10,000 machine. I'm going to want somebody to write a whizzy compiler for my machine. And everybody wants speed, and that's one of the things that people pay for, and so people care about it. Furthermore, as these languages become more and more sophisticated and programmers are asking the language to do more and more of the work for them in object-oriented languages and so on, these additional language features the dynamic method lookups and some of the object-oriented languages, for example, do incur runtime overheads. They are expensive in terms of performance. There's no getting around it. And the compiler has to do something about that to make these languages usable.
What role might symbolic languages play in increasing programmer productivity?
Well, first here, I want to put in a good word for some of the new paradigms, like logic programming, for example. I did not talk about logic programming to a great extent because I don't know how to compile logic programming efficiently. That's not the kind of compiler optimization I know how to do, but they are an important area of symbolic languages. And the beauty of logic programming, for example, is that one can express one's problem in a more declarative form. And I write down what my problem is, and the computer is responsible for solving that problem. And I think that's a lot of what symbolic languages offer, a more declarative way of writing problems. It may still be a procedural language, such as the ones that I've talked about, but they do have fewer side effects, and they do allow a simpler expression of the problem. And I think, ultimately, programmer productivity is going to depend on our ability to reuse software. We're going to have to be able to build components that are generally useful and can be used in many projects and by many different people. I think the key to that is to be able to specify them very simply and very generally. And the key there is simplicity. We can't have complicated interfaces. We can't have something that gives me an object and then I have to worry about returning the storage of that object. It needs to be encapsulated in some manner with a very simple interface, or these reusable abstractions aren't going to work. And I think that, in fact, is why the concept of reusable software has not been very successful with conventional programming languages. The languages themselves have too many complicating features so that you can't specify a simple interface for any useful and interesting piece of code, just about.
And our final question. You seem to be a great believer in simplicity. Why do you think this is so important?
Well, I think programming is a hard task, and I think a lot of what we're trying to do in modern technology is hard. And it's not like we ourselves are that different from our ancestors who lived in caves. We are very finite beings, and there's only a certain amount of complexity that we can cope with, we ourselves. Our machines can cope with a great deal more than we can, and that's why our machines are so important and so interesting, because they're increasing our ability to deal with complexity. But we ourselves can't do it very well, and you really discover that whenever you go to program something. Programming is one of the most humbling activities I know. That may be why programmers often have such big egos. They have to have they have to think highly of themselves, or they couldn't survive the humility of having a computer tell you that you've made a mistake.
Thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
And thank you for joining us today. We invite your comments and questions on this presentation, and we hope you will make nominations for other speakers and topics in the series. If you are viewing this lecture on tape, we've provided feedback postcards tucked under the video cassette label. If you're not doing this on tape, our address is at the end. Thank you very much.